So I'm just gonna invite us all to prayer. I'm just gonna pray, and then we're gonna end with the Lord's Prayer, if that's okay with everyone. Okay, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for this season that, even though it's cold, that Lord, you've given us so much reasons to be warm, if not physically, but Lord, spiritually and emotionally, Lord, with our families and ultimately with you this season. God, I pray that as we begin this service, may we do so in remembrance of the gift that you gave in your Son, that you so loved the world, that you gave your Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish. So Lord, we give you all the glory today. And just as the Lord taught us how to pray, let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. But lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the glory, and the power, forever. Amen. You know, we see it.
It's always good to start with reading of the Word of God. I'm going to be reading from Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child, and will give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. On Isaiah 9, verse 6, it says, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulder, and he will be called the Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. May the reading of the Word be blessed.
Thank you, Dom. I hope our people are on their way, and maybe some of them are still in the building. I hope they hear you all. Last Sunday, we have lighted the candle of joy. Today we're going to light the fourth candle, which is the candle of love. And then on December 23, that would be on Friday, 6 o'clock. You're making me nervous. On December 23, 6 o'clock, we are going to light the candle of Christ. I'd like to invite everyone to please come on December 23, this coming Friday. We are going to have the candle service, the candlelight service. Again, we're going to light the first candle, which is the candle of hope. I would like to ask Ryan and Hope, please come and light the shortest candle there. Ryan and Hope, be reminded that you are serving a God who is a God of hope. As you would say, being a new couple, there are lots of challenges out there. But remember, you're serving a God of hope. Thank you so much. second candle, which is the candle piece. I would like to ask the Fernandez family to please come, Rudy and Anne, and the kids, please come as you would light the candle piece. Please come. Rudy and Anne and the kids, please come. But anyway, Cody and I, we, despite of the challenges that you went through, but God has brought peace in your hearts. With all the challenges you have, imagine you're here together. And as well as Rap and Vinvin, with God's grace, Ronvin, he will perform miracles in his life. We never know. But again, Rodi and Anne, be reminded, whatever challenges you have, you're serving a God of peace. Maybe the world is trying to give you a peace, but it will not last. So Jesus Christ, he is the Prince of Peace. Thank you so much. Please light the one of the candles. Yeah. Candle joint. I would like to ask Ador and the family to please come and light the candle of joint. Please come. Be reminded that we may not have all the things in this world, but in spite of all those, you know, material things, we don't have it in our hands. But remember, the God that you're serving is a God of joy. Jesus Christ himself is the joy of our Heavenly Father. If you have Jesus Christ in your hand, it doesn't matter what you have. What matters most is Jesus Christ. If you have that person, you have joy. Would you like to adore the that and the young? The candle of love. I would like to call the Principe family, Dawn and Glenda, and V.S. versus Magella, or maybe downstairs. Please come. I believe Glenda could memorize Jeremiah 16. Right, Glenn? Who can you memorize that piece?
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life.
Praise the Lord. God is love. He gave us his only begotten Son. Glenda and Don, Michaela and D.S., with all the challenges that you went through, but you have tested how Glenda is so in love with it. spite of all these challenges, Glenda remaining in love with you. What I tell you, Glenn and Don, there is someone who is in love with you. He gave his only begotten son to show to us that he loves us so much. Let me pray for you. Father in heaven, we thank you so much that you are the old Lord of love. And this world could never define the word love because God is love. Father, thank you, Lord, for this family in Adom and Glenda and the kids. With all the challenges that they went through, you have shown your love to them. You never failed them, good one. Father, thank you. Continue to bind this couple with your love. Help them, Lord, that they will continue to show love to each other. Father, once again, thank you for this couple. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Don't would you light the candle, the last candle. Thank you so much.
He was given a mission. And I don't know if you read a accepted it, or it was something of a bitter disappointment to him. And yet how he comes together with his wife Mary and accepts his mission. The Christian Missionary Alliance president, Mr. Dave Hearn, has challenged all the 450 Alliance churches across Canada. And he has challenged us to three things. He said, the Alliance churches across Canada will be Christ-centered, will be Spirit-empowered, and they'll be mission-focused. And so I want to just talk to you for a few moments here this evening about what it means to be on mission. I've entitled my short message to be Bethlehem Mission through the eyes of Joseph. He was given a unique assignment, and I'm going to read that from Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to verse 25. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Kind of odd that they were pledged to be married, and yet he's going to divorce her. I'll say something more about that just in a moment. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is with the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said to the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. And when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife, but he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. There's a poem written by Robert Frost that I have always appreciated and loved. It goes something like this, the road not taken. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveler long I stood and looked down one far as I could to where it bent under the undergrowth. And then it goes on to a number of other stanzas, and it ends with this, I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. I couldn't help but think of this young man called Joseph. I'm sure his bitter disappointment upon the news that his betrothed, his wife-to-be, was pregnant. He must have gone home and just wept. And yet, when an angel of the Lord comes to him, he responds with a deliberate choice, and it made all the difference in the world. There's times when all of us are faced with a critical choice, a critical divergence upon our road as well, and we need to make a choice as well. And so what can we learn from the lessons of Joseph? First of all, I'm going to talk about Joseph's bitter disappointment and then his response. We find in this passage that I read that Joseph was a righteous man. He's a carpenter's son. He built plows, animal yokes, furniture. He's a hard-working, pious man. He must have been at least 25 years of age, because that was the average married age of that period of time. It was likely a prearranged wedding, because that's the way it was there. And yet we have some confusion here as he wants to consider divorcing his one whom he's engaged with. And in our North American culture, of course, we have courtship, then we have engagement, and then we have the wedding. There are three stages to it. And of course, nowadays, maybe there's some changes with cohabitation, but nevertheless, in the Jewish custom, there was an engagement, a betrothal, and then there was marriage. Now let me just say, the engagement period, again, was usually arranged by the parents. A promise was granted without a few wedding details. it could be broken off without any serious consequences at all. Then there was the betrothal period, which was generally for a 1-year period. It was a binding agreement. Basically, in the eyes of the Jewish community, the couple was viewed as married already, except they would not have a sexual union or didn't live together. If a man died during the betrothal period, he would leave behind a virgin widow. To back out of that arrangement would take writing a divorce, a letter of divorce. And so here we find this couple is between the betrothal and the wedding period. They were looking forward to a future together when Joseph receives the news. He's an honorable man, he's a righteous man, and somehow he must have been sense betrayed. What was this about an immaculate conception? What went on when maybe Mary visited her relative Elizabeth? And yet Mary had a quiet confidence about her. There seemed to be a love and an excitement that she was looking forward to, while Joseph must have been devastated. He went home perhaps and wept. He had an unexpected curveball. Have you ever experienced the unexpected, the unplanned? Maybe a medical report that didn't go as you expected? An accident that you didn't see coming? Employment, termination of employment? Unexpected pregnancy, loss of a child, loss of a loved one, moving to a new locale. It seems the Christmas story is so full of the unexpected, just like that thing now. Unexpected, eh? We have an illustration of it right before our eyes. Nothing goes easy. Nothing goes smooth in that first Christmas. Mary's pregnancy. Wasn't supposed to happen this way. Poor timing for a census. Now go to Bethlehem. What should he do? Should he leave his loved one there? And he'll take her with him. No suitable accommodation in Bethlehem. He must have thought, what next is going to happen? Joseph was looking forward to a wedding, not an unexpected pregnancy, not an unplanned pregnancy. Joseph finds himself at a crossroad. Which path should he take? Well, he makes a deliberate choice. That's often forced upon us as well. We're forced, will we obey or will we move away? Again, he must have had a sense of betrayal. What were his options? It says in this scripture passage, it said maybe he could marry her quickly and deflect the gossip and the criticism. But there would be further complications to that. Perhaps he could publicly divorce her, leave her in the arms or the hands of the religious elite and the law set to stone a person like that. Or perhaps he could just simply annul this betrothal arrangement, the marriage contract, and send Mary quietly on his longer way. Joseph chose the latter option. One thing seemed to emerge with great clarity, that Joseph had a supreme love for Mary. He loved her. He wanted her treated well. The only thing he thought he could do was divorce her privately and let her go on her way. Joseph never guessed that there was another option, that there was. He experiences a dream, as I read in this passage in verse 20, an angel reassures Joseph. A child is conceived in Mary is born of the Holy Spirit. Mary's immaculate conception was foretold in the Old Testament. It says there in Isaiah 7:14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with the child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. Joseph shows obedience. When he woke up from the dream, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. I want to just say a number of lessons that we can learn from Joseph's response. I want to say three things. First of all, doing the will of God is not always easy. Look at the life of Joseph. He endured gossip, criticism, hardship, threats, fleeing to spare his son's life to Egypt and then returning again. If you know something of the Gospels or of the early letters of the Apostle Paul, his ministry was characterized by troubles, hardships, beatings, imprisonments, sleepless nights, and hunger. Even consider the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. He faced a growing opposition within his ministry, and finally was brutally nailed to the cross. Following Jesus has its blessings, it has its joys, but it also has its trials, it also has its testings. Being in the center of God's will is not always easy, but it's the most blessed place to be. To find that center, what is it that God wants us to do? Secondly, doing the will of God is often marked by the unexpected. Plans seemingly go awry. God shapes us during those times. Life is a faith journey. We think of the heroes of Hebrews chapter 11, and it says that each one exhibited faith in the midst of facing obstacles and challenges. By faith, it says Noah trusted in God, even when told to build an ark in the desert. By faith, Abraham was willing to risk and to sacrifice. By faith, Moses chose to suffer for the kingdom of God. Faith calls us to press forward in the face of difficult odds. So if you're facing the challenge, keep going. Keep moving. Keep trusting. Your faith will be rewarded. Thirdly, doing the will of God at times implies just dogged perseverance. Four times, Joseph gets up. We read in chapter 1 and in chapter 2. He gets up in obedience to the message that was given to him from God, and he obeys. He goes to Egypt, and the angel speaks to him while in Egypt he returns. The angel speaks to him, and he doesn't go the way of Judea, but goes rather into Galilee. He obeys. He does what he's been instructed to do. He makes a deliberate choice. Here's what I admire about Joseph. Every fork and curve in the road, Joseph chooses God. He expresses his faith in obedience. He makes a deliberate choice. He didn't know the future, but he knows the holds it. And so I ask you this Christmas, what are the circumstances in your life? What's maybe unexpected, perhaps even unwanted, even at this Christmas? What will you say as you're faced with a fork in the road, like Joseph did? Which way should I go? I don't know how God will work this thing out, but I choose to trust him. Charles Spurgeon, a famous queen of theologians and pastors, wrote this: when I can't see his hand, I'll trust his heart. Job said, but he knows the way that I take, and when he has tested me, I'll come forth as gold. Apostle Peter said, these have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes, even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine, may result in praise and glory and honor. Friend, perhaps your faith is even being tested at this Christmas season. Maybe with the economy, or whatever family, or whatever the case might be. I want to encourage you to be like Joseph. At every fork in the road, lean towards him, our Heavenly Father, and his will. Find it and walk in. May your spirit be soft and tender. Do what's right. Do what's honorable. Don't cave in to despair or anger. God has his purpose. He has an assignment. He has a mission for you, just like he had for Joseph. Keep going. Keep trusting. I guarantee it'll make a difference. For you, for your family, for your loved ones, for all eternity. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful Christmas season. Thank you for the congregation and house of prayer, for each individual gathered here, each boy and girl, each young person. And Lord, we pray that when those times come in our own life where we choose to follow, pursue after you, or perhaps it's too hard and difficult, we want to move back and move away. Lord, we pray that you would give us the courage and the strength to move forward, just like Joseph did. And I pray that as a result, your name will be honored and lifted up, and we will celebrate Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Thank you.